Thank you. Thank you. Before we move on, I do just want to say really quickly, we have a lot of people who helped make tonight possible. So if you see any of these people, David Morrison, Helen Keller, Mai Chung, David Fryer, Laura Hardy Stewart, James Moore, Ed Weinberg, Lemon Gab, Tu Huang Nguyen, Raphael Dorner, Killian Hippocrates, Huai Tu, or myself, if you can just say thank you before you leave would be really, really nice. Okay. And if you're interested in maybe joining this team, you can also talk to me afterwards. Oh, all right, guys. We have a bunch of really cool things planned for us tonight. All right, so first of all, as you know, there were these recent deaths at the Tejo Water Park, and there was a lot of rumors and a lot of confusion over what happened. So I just want to clarify some of those things and have a bit of a conversation around that. Second, a drug that a lot of us don't really think of as being a drug, but actually the most widely used drug in the world is caffeine. And most of us have no idea how it works, but it's actually really interesting the way that it works. So we're going to get into that some too. Justin's nodding his head. Awesome. Thank you, Justin. Then we're going to take a look at the war on drugs, go through the history of that a little bit, hear your thoughts on the positives and the consequences of the whole war on drugs. And then Ed Weinberg is here, and he's going to be sharing a story of taking ayahuasca down in Cambodia for us, and also field some questions from you guys in case you have any questions about what that experience was like. We're going to be looking into the history of LSD and where it is today, and then James Moore will be performing a rap for us about marijuana. Is anybody a James Moore fan? Do you know him? Yeah? Okay. One person, two people. Sorry, James. I hope that by the end of the night we're all James Moore fans. He's really, really talented. Okay, cool, guys. So the first thing that we're here to discuss will give us about 10 minutes for this one. And the question is, what is a drug? Like, I don't think that we presume that that an avocado is a drug or that a carrot is a drug, but it certainly changes maybe the way that we perceive the world. If we ate nothing but peas, it would certainly change the way that we see the world. What is it that separates drugs from all other things that we don't call drugs? Caffeine, tobacco, alcohol, nicotine, well, and tobacco. So that's the question, what is a drug? So at this point, especially if you're new here, we're going to break up into small groups. A good size for a small group is about 5 people. So you might need to, your clusters are probably too big as they're set up right now. So try, really, believe me, it's best, the smaller number you get, the better. Try to make a little small group of about 5 people. And you can start to discuss this question, what is a drug? All right, guys, so we have about 10 minutes. Go for it. Okay, and we're back. Hello. Hello, everybody. Good to see you all again. I feel like I haven't seen you in years. What's going on? Okay, so does anybody want to maybe just raise their hand? And what is one like necessary component of something being a drug? Anybody? Yeah, Matt.
It has an effect.
Okay, so it's a substance maybe that has an effect. Awesome, okay, so it has an effect. And then, yes?
Something that alters the state of the body at that time.
Something that alters the state of the body? Okay, all right. Yes?
We decided that it alters your brain.
And also alters your brain. Cool, yes. Anybody else? Good. Yes?
Something you ingest.
And something you ingest, okay.
I think it has something to do with intention as well.
So you're saying that something could be taken as a drug intentionally, but without the intention of it being a drug, then maybe it's not a drug. Like, I think cacao can be taken like a drug, or cacao could just be taken as an ingredient in a recipe, not really being a drug. Or maybe the alcoholic content in ayahuasca, you know, the alcohol is either a drug or not really a drug.
Exactly. Yeah. Okay. Or to include abusing something that wouldn't alter your state of mind with the intent of abusing it.
Yeah, excellent. Yeah, good. Yeah, thank you very much, guys. So it's the idea that if you are intending to abuse something as well, then there's a problem with addiction. But if you're not really tending to abuse it or tending to use it as a drug, then there's less of a chance of it actually being, they're developing a substance abuse. Okay, so thank you guys for getting into that. I think it's a really difficult question to answer, actually. You know, it's one thing in philosophy. We tend to believe that we should be able to fit words within a particular... we should be able to create a definition or fit words within a particular box and say that, yes, this is what a drug is, this thing is not a drug. But actually, you know, there are a lot of words that, even though we use them pretty often, we don't really know what we're talking about when we use these words. But that doesn't change the fact that drug is still a word that we can use. So, as we move on throughout the night and we have these small group discussions, I just want you to keep in mind there's so much more that I want to be able to tell you guys that we just can't fit in 2.5 hours. I'd love to have a whole year of weekly discussions just spent on drugs, but we just can't do it. So instead, my hope is I'm going to show you some kind of cool stuff up on this screen, or at least interesting stuff, but it's not nearly as much as I want to, but all of this is just to contextualize a conversation that you're going to be having. That's where all of the real benefit of this comes from. Okay, so moving on. I think that drugs have maybe been in our mind a bit more recently because of the recent deaths at the Tejo Water Park. Has everybody heard of this at least somewhat already? And unfortunately for a lot of our English-speaking crowd, a lot of what we hear is mostly rumors. We don't really get to see, we don't get to read any of the state media. So I had a friend going through a lot of the media with me so that we could compile and condense a lot of the information that exists so far, although there are a lot of cracks. So can I tell you guys a little bit about these water park deaths and what we know so far? Okay, cool. So, it was portrayed in all of the media sources, whether they were in official magazines that were by the state or even some unofficial sources. They all kind of had the generally same account of what happened. So it was on Sunday, the 16th of December, and the first ambulance was called right around 10:30 p.m. There was the Vietnam Electronic Weekend, VEW, at Westlake Park. Everybody knows Westlake Park, I imagine, the big Ferris wheel. Yeah. So this was being billed, and some sources say that it certainly was, but I haven't really been able to verify, but it was billed as being the largest electronic music festival that Vietnam has ever had. It's hard to imagine that all of that would fit just in Tejo Water Park, but there were about 5,000 people in the audience, and the vast majority of them were young, somewhere between the age of 19 and 30 years old. People who were there, I don't know, has anybody talked to anybody who was actually at this festival? A couple people. Yeah, okay, wow, great. So as you talk to people, one of the common things that said about this is that everybody was squeezed really tightly together. There was very little space, and everybody's very hot. Maybe you're doing drugs, so you're losing a lot more water than you would otherwise. And it wasn't a very comfortable, and it was a very hot environment. Okay, so according to a representative from the Ministry of Health, 5 died in E Hospital. E Hospital is just about 7 kilometers away from Tejo Water Park. And then 2 died at the Hanoi Heart Hospital. And 5 people are currently comatose. So these people have not yet died, but they're currently comatose. So it's 12 people in total who've been critically affected by whatever it was that happened at the Tejo Water Park. Does anybody know what drug it was that these people were taking? MDMA, ecstasy, okay, anybody else? Heroin, meth, anybody else?
Fentanyl.
Marijuana, okay. Fentanyl, okay. Yeah, so unfortunately, this hasn't actually been released yet. We don't know what the drug was. So the government had released these figures, but they haven't actually let us know what the drug was that these people were taking. So if we want to take measures to protect ourselves, it's actually kind of difficult, I think. So, all of the people who died were between the ages of 18 and 29 years old. And when they went to the hospital, they were all tested positive for narcotics. But once again, we don't know what those narcotics were. So there are investigations that are currently underway that are trying to figure out more about this. And some city leaders did go to the hospital to visit these people. So I think that when we hear this story, we have a very particular response to it. We being people who are interested in exploring ideas around drugs. But this is not the way that everybody responded to this loss. So As I said, that they didn't actually say exactly what kind of drug that it was. That they did say that at the festival in general, they found MDMA, and they did find meth, and they found a lot of nitrous oxide balloons. You know, we're not going to talk about it. At least I won't be talking about it up here. But probably most of us are familiar with the recent death caused by drowning after someone passed out from taking a nitrous oxide balloon. So they found a lot of those there as well, although they haven't verified which one was actually found in the deceased. So in official media, they frequently refer to matoi, or ghost tripping. And ghost tripping normally refers to crack cocaine. So this is one that maybe was also there at the time. But in this case, this is a term that's actually being used as like a big umbrella term for just many different kinds of drugs. So it can refer simultaneously to both. Now, on social media, the response was incredibly, incredibly negative, unfortunately. So there seemed to be a lot of rage online. And as you scour through a lot of the comments on different people's Facebook walls or in different groups, they tend to blame the victims and say that the victims deserved to die if they took these drugs. They said the victims are dirty, and that the city leaders should not be visiting these people in hospitals. A couple of translated quotes. This all comes from Mai Chong, who's not able to be with us here tonight, but if you know her and you see her, you can say thank you for helping putting all of this together. She translated a few of these for us. She said, it's a chance to clean the land, is what some people had said online. Yes?
So I'm curious to know what forum she's using.
Cool. Awesome. Yeah, I really wish that she were here tonight so that I'd be able to give a response. My only connection with Vietnamese forums is through her. So I could send her a message right now, actually, and in between I'll see if I can get back to you on that one. Does that sound good? Yeah, cool. Thank you. And of course, I think it's definitely necessary to say that like we can't presume that all Vietnamese are thinking about this in one particular way, but at least there is this rage that is represented somewhere online, I think is definitely the fairer way to put it. Some people said trip to the moon, trip to hell, or trip to the moon, literally. Also on social media, I don't want to butcher Vietnamese, I'm sorry. But the translation of this phrase is, you are not hairy Westerners to go to the sun. And this really means you are not Westerners enough to use these drugs. So in association in a lot of the conversations around this tragedy, that they frequently also mentioned this 2017 case that happened in Mai Dinh. In Mai Dinh, they said the injured were said to use Khao Mi, which is American grass or weed, right, is the name for it. My Vietnamese isn't great, I'm sorry, but this is what I've got. Okay, so there was some response from the law so far. Maybe you guys have heard, but this is from Chuang Minh Tien, who's the deputy director of Hanoi's Department of Culture and Sport. He said, all music festivals in Hanoi have been suspended until further notice. Yeah. So has anybody, I haven't actually heard of a music festival being told that they had to shut down. Has anybody heard of a music festival being told? Yeah, Chris, what happened?
Revolve.
What did they say about Revolve?
I know that the organizers contacted and recommended they don't run it, but I think it's been rearranged. I know that the Minx Festival has to shorten to one day as opposed to two. I'm not sure about that.
So Revolve, Minx Festival. I was talking to Mark from Quest, and he said that it's probably that it's not being affected as of now because it's not held in Hanoi, in case anybody's worried about that. Yeah, Adine.
Yeah,
okay. Yeah, EDM concert specifically. Cool. Yeah, thank you, Adine. So the case is now on trial. So there's a public investigation, which is maybe one of the reasons why a lot of the information about the specifics of the case haven't yet been released. And who is to blame will be defined after this case concludes. Now, little, again, information has been released on what kind of drug, and it seems like, so far, this is from Mai Chung, that what the courts and what the investigation care more about is who is to blame rather than what drug was to blame. Speaking for me personally, I would much rather know what drug it was that actually caused these deaths that we know it to avoid. Yeah, please. So these were found at the event. I'm not sure if you were here for it, but I mean, it seems like we all have a different idea of what drug was being taken there. Yeah, because it's mostly rumors that are going around. Yeah, please.
Was it just the drugs that killed them? No, was it the conditions in Pakistan with the old salt?
Yeah, well, it's hard to say that drugs actually ever kill people. You know, people don't die from taking MDMA. They die from being dehydrated after taking MDMA. You know, something like this. So yeah, it's certainly a mixture of the two, regardless. Yeah, please. Yeah.
One of the guys here actually, can I tell us this?
Sorry. So one of the guys who died was a friend of my cousin, and she told me that it was kind of like bad quality of ecstasy. In one particular case, I don't know about the other ones, and I also want to say something about the past part.
Yeah, please.
While you talk about the social media response, I just want to say like I think that we shouldn't imagine like portray the United States with Trump supporters. So like,
yeah, right,
and
yeah.
And especially not like the little kids who are like writing and saying stuff like that. Like I think most of Vietnamese people, as you, if you live here, you're expats, you know how people are treating people. So I don't think that it's the majority of the people what they say. So I think it's a bit sensationalist to, yeah, and like a little bit one-sided.
Cool, okay, yeah, thank you.
Cheers.
Can you turn it off actually while we pass it through? Because I don't want to get that feedback, yeah, cool.
Yeah, I hope that showing this information, especially to any Vietnamese, isn't coming across as offensive or one-sided. I do recognize this. I thought that by partnering up with a Vietnamese person to do this, that we'd actually avoid that problem. But certainly, if you want to speak up more about this, I really appreciate you saying that. Actually, yeah. Okay, and that's actually that leads us in exactly to the next little discussion that we have. So, do victims of drug overdose deserve sympathy and respect? Or do they deserve to die? That's the question. Hello. Hello. Welcome back. Hello, everybody. So everybody here thinks that they deserve to die, right? Is that right? Okay, great. Thank you. So I do want to say I did potentially make a mistake, actually, by only sourcing this from one person, and would love to hear from any other, specifically Vietnamese in the audience, of what you've seen on social media and what you feel is the general response to these water park deaths. So would anybody like to just quickly stand up and say a little something? Yeah, please, six. Yeah, six.
Thanks. So basically, I think what he represented back on there was kind of true for the general responses of Vietnamese people. It's basically rage. And I think it's very much we try to divert a responsibility into always one party after any kind of incident. So in this case, for these people that, I don't know, I think it's either people don't talk about it, or if they talk about it, they'll be like, you know, like that. So for these people, they direct either that into these city representatives for coming to visit these people and at the same time at these people. Yeah. But yeah, at the end of the day, I don't think nobody deserved to die.
Yeah, thank you very much, Six. Anybody else from the audience would like to speak on this? Maybe we can hear one more, and then we'll move on. A Vietnamese, if we could. Yeah, please.
I'm so sorry. So sorry.
Yeah, personally, I don't think anyone deserves to die, but because on Facebook, especially in Vietnam, a lot of people don't have enough education background, and they're really confrontational, and sometimes people say mean things on the internet because they're not face-to-face. For example, if the people who died is one of their friends, they wouldn't say the same thing. I think it's about the relationship between them and the people who died.
Okay. All right, yeah. So thank you very much, guys. Thank you for sharing that. Thank you. All right, so cool. So I got a little weird one for you guys. This is something that I'm a little nerdy about this, but it's like one of my favorite little stories. Does anybody in here know how caffeine works? Does anybody? Oh yeah, of course. Yeah, thank you. Anybody else? Yeah. Okay. Cool. All right. Awesome. Oh, good. Two. Okay. So caffeine is certainly the most widely consumed drug in the world, I suppose, depending on how you define the word drug. So there are 100,000 metric tons of caffeine that are consumed annually. This is not coffee beans, 100,000 metric tons of coffee beans. This is 100,000 metric tons of caffeine consumed annually. That's as much as 14 times the weight of the Eiffel Tower. 14 Eiffel Towers of just caffeine consumed every year. So we'll get into a little bit the way that it works. Most people don't know this. There's actually no energy in caffeine. Like if you were to burn it, you know, like a calorie, caffeine doesn't actually have any calories. It doesn't give you energy in that way. So if it doesn't give you energy in that way, how does it give you energy? Okay, we're gonna unpack this. So stay with me. Caffeine works as an adenosine receptor antagonist. And I'm going to tell you what that means. An adenosine receptor antagonist. Does anybody know what adenosine is? Adenosine. So adenosine is the byproduct of all neurological activity. Whenever your brain does something interesting, you know, when you're working on a math problem, it starts releasing all this adenosine. If you're thinking really hard and solving Sudoku, it's going to be releasing all this adenosine, okay? And then you have thousands of these adenosine... Lemon's getting excited. That's great. Thank you. You have thousands of these adenosine receptors all over the brain, and they keep track of how much neurological activity you've done. Okay, so then when these adenosine receptors are activated, when they receive adenosine and they're like, okay, you know what? We have done enough neurological activity. I think it's time to start slowing down because we've been doing enough work. And the way that we slow things down is by releasing serotonin, right? Releasing melatonin, start calming down the body. Okay, well, caffeine, the molecule, is a doppelganger for the adenosine molecule. So you have all of these receptors all over your brain, and the caffeine molecule gets lodged inside of those receptors, and it blocks any of the adenosine molecules from getting in. And this says that this forces your brain to not start releasing serotonin and melatonin, so you can just keep going and going and going. Okay, so it blocks the adenosine receptors, it doesn't activate them, and then your brain goes, oh no, oh my god, we're not getting any adenosine, this is a real problem. Hey James, we're not getting adenosine, this is a real problem. If there's no adenosine that's being released, this means the brain isn't actually doing any neurological activity. And if it's not doing any neurological activity, then there's something wrong. We need to jumpstart the brain. And what do we use to jumpstart the brain or jumpstart the body? Adrenaline, perfect, yeah. So the blockage of these adenosine receptors, it starts to release adrenaline. Now, what is adrenaline used for? Fight or flight, perfect, yeah. It's the fight or flight hormone. So it's this supply of energy that we have saved up inside of us just in case there's a giant bear that's gonna be running after us. It doesn't matter how tired we are, and as we're snuggled up next to the fire, sleeping with all of our caveman buddies, it doesn't matter how tired we are. Well, as soon as we hear this bear, the adrenaline starts to release, and then we get up and we have all the energy in the whole world. Okay, not only does adrenaline give us this energy? This is the effect that we're aware of. But it forces our brain to start asking the question, what is attacking me right now? In what way am I under attack? So that we can find the bear, so we know what the problem is, okay? This is why caffeine makes us really, really good at pointing out problems. It makes us really good at telling somebody that they're wrong and how they're wrong and how ourselves are wrong. And this causes all of these terrible things. So of course the pupils dilate, the airways open up, the heart begins to beat faster, there's increased blood flow, increased blood pressure, the blood flow to the stomach starts to slow, And the liver releases sugar into the bloodstream for extra energy at this time, right? Okay, but then there are also all of these problems, right? So, oh, let's talk about the benefits first. I'm sorry, guys. Okay, so... So, a couple of the benefits of caffeine. Oh, no. So, caffeine has been shown to reduce the risks of Parkinson's, of Alzheimer's, and some cancers. So, this is good. And also, if you are doing some math problems, or if you're paid to point out flaws in people or in projects, then caffeine is actually really good. So it's also really good for physical performance. It increases your body's ability to burn fat. So if you're doing the same workout, but you're doing it one day with coffee, you're actually just going to be burning more fat during this workout. This is so, the physical performance is so enhanced through the use of caffeine that from 1972 until 2004, the Olympics set a limit to the amount of caffeine that its competitors could consume. Yeah, Ellie.
The NCAA still bans caffeine.
Wow, cool. Thank you. Thank you, Ellie. Yeah. Wow, wild. Cool. Okay, but there are these consequences too, right? Can you guys name any? What are some of the consequences when you guys drink caffeine? Especially this, yeah. Anxiety, yeah, is a big one. Anybody else? What is it? Trembling with the hands. Yeah, exactly. Anything else? Lack of, I thought you said neck, okay, yeah, lack of empathy, good, okay. Lack of, oh, so I'm really interested in this one. So I don't think that anybody has done an experiment on whether or not drinking coffee makes us greedier, but I really have a presumption that it may, that people who drink more caffeine are more concentrated on their own survival, maybe, they're more scared all the time, so they just act a bit more solipsistically, and they don't want to give, they don't want to give so much to other people. Yeah, okay, so we hit a bunch of them. I'll roll down this list, you know, increased heart rate, blood pressure, causes us to urinate quite a bit more, and it causes diarrhea in some people. It does cause anxiety, it does cause paranoia. Has anybody ever mixed caffeine with weed in here? Don't put up your hands. So, but you might know that there are some very negative effects of this. Hello. And of course, it causes insomnia. And there's an addiction that really is associated with caffeine. So when these adenosine receptors are blocked, I'm actually going to speed through this because it's... But it, when these adenosine receptors are blocked, your brain starts to grow more adenosine receptors so that it can receive the adenosine. So then it actually requires you to drink more coffee so that you can block all of the adenosine receptors so that your body stops producing serotonin and melatonin. And this causes real withdrawal symptoms. So maybe you guys have experienced this before, if you've ever tried to get off Vietnamese coffee, which is like crack. It causes headaches, causes tiredness, causes depression, causes more fights with your partner. And in just a few days, after you were to stop drinking coffee, the adenosine receptors will disappear. And the extra ones will disappear. You'll need the same amount of adenosine to trigger the release of serotonin and melatonin, and you'll go back to normal in just a couple days. Just take those 3 days if you want to, and get off the coffee, guys. That's the point of all of this. I'm really here just to convince you to stay off coffee. Yeah, Lemon.
I have got an interesting fact on adenosine.
Yeah, can
I... Love fun facts.
Is my voice not loud enough? Okay, so I recently quit cigarettes.
Yeah.
But I still split sometimes. Okay, but cigarettes was a big thing. But for 2 weeks, I was like fucking tired. Like, could not move out of bed for hours. And I was like, what is wrong with me? I type in Google, why when I quit cigarettes am I abnormally tired? Well, what nicotine does is it mimics adenosine.
Yeah.
It mimics it, so your body virtually stops creating it altogether. Mm. So as if you were just drinking coffee, your body would still be creating it. With nicotine, it stops altogether and can take up to 30 days for the levels, for your adenosine levels to level back out, and then up to 3 months to get your dopamine and serotonin back to normal. It took 3 weeks to not take 2 hour naps in the middle of the afternoon because of putting cigarettes. So yeah, think about putting cigarettes and get all your energy back. Woo!
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Lemon. Thank you very much for that. I was wondering if we might even have some time tonight, and maybe we'll still do it. I'm not too sure. Maybe we can just hang out a little after to get some people to be able to just share any wild experiences that you might have had on drugs, if you want to. It's all up to you guys. Maybe we'll do that after we officially close at 10 o'clock. We'll just have a little bit of a small circle doing that. All right, guys. So the next thing that I'd like to do, we're going to take about... we're going to take about 5 minutes for a little conversation. We're going to set up a little bit of tech here. So I'm going to bring up James Moore. James Moore, could you stand up for me, please? Yeah, thank you very much. So,
awesome, yeah.
Some applause. Good. You deserve it. You deserve it, buddy. I think that we're going to take just a little bit of time to set up some of the equipment. And in that time, you guys can really talk about what you want to. But the question that I have proposed, and really, you can like embrace the tangents, guys. Wherever this one goes, you just keep following down that tunnel, wherever it goes. But the question is, why are some drugs legal and other drugs illegal? Caffeine certainly is a drug. Why is this one legal, whereas weed is illegal, right? Okay, so maybe we can get our heads around that one. We can talk about that some. Go for it. 5, 10-ish minutes, and then we're going to hear from James. Can I get a round of applause for James Moore? Please, thank you very much. So James Moore had created... I'm not sure. I got it. Yeah, it's all good. It's all good. So James had decided to create... he's a spoken word artist here in Hanoi. How long have you been here in Hanoi now?
Almost a year.
Okay. So James has been making the rounds all around, sharing his art form with other people. And tonight he offered to show us a little bit of what he's got. He's written 3 pieces for us tonight about his relationship with different drugs over the last few years. And I don't want to speak too much. I think the words speak for themselves. So, James, I'll give it over to you. One more round of applause for James, please.
Hello, everybody. Just like everybody in this room, I have a relatively complicated history of drugs. But when John asked me to write some stuff about drugs, it kind of got me thinking just generally about vices, habits, addictions. So, yeah, this isn't just strictly going to be like, I smoked some weed, then I did some pills, then I do-do-do. So it's going to be about life in general and how that all feeds into those wonderful things. So yeah, let's go ahead and I'll stop talking and start rapping. All right. So are you, bags underneath these eyes, what are we to do? Thoughts running through my mind like a sprinter do. Torn apart from inside when I think of you. Shit, things change so quickly. Thoughts rearrange, I just pray that she miss me. Turning through the page, paint the frame with a brush stroke. Questioning where the love and the trust go, where the lust go. Shit, never left, I've been getting into trouble with these girls failing tests. I still beat her on the double, if you needed me, I swear. I beat her on the double, if you needed me, I swear. I can't keep track of these lies. I'm writing these tracks as a vice. I used to roll up a spliff and then vibe. That shit no longer agrees with my mind. I can't keep track of these lies. And writing these tracks is a vice. I used to roll up a spliff and then vibe. That shit no longer agrees in my mind. That shit no longer agrees in my soul. That shit no longer agrees in my heart. Thankful I met you cause you played your part. Glad that I met you and end has a start. I can't keep track of these lies. And writing these tracks is a vice. I used to roll up a spliff and then vibe. I used to na 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 na. Tired, and so are you. Bags underneath these eyes, what are we to do? Thoughts running through my mind like a sprinter do. Torn apart from inside when I think of you. I can't keep track of these lies. And writing these tracks is a vice. I used to roll up a spliff and then vibe. Okay, that's the first song. The music's really quiet. It was cool before. So, That was awful. Don't worry, we'll get a little louder. It's right to get the music a little bit louder. Can we do Souvenir next? Thank you. Yes, my friend. All right. I was stuck in the mud, I was stuck in my ways. 20-something rolling up, just smoking that haze. All the time I would waste, I was trapped in a maze. Still amazed by the fact that me and you doing great. And look, occasional female company comforts me, but shit, she isn't you. Ugh, and I'm not him. But I'm not mad as long as he does what it says on the tin. No more lies in the sink, you don't need that. She hit my phone and it beeps without feedback. News of you and him felt like getting kneecapped. But still been brewing up these hits like a tea bag. Look, your dad brewed the best pour. Pick up where we left off. No, that isn't life. Fuck. It's wishful thinking, I guess. Busy swiping right, drinking and connecting the flesh. Is this as good as it gets? It's young Jack Nicholson, is this as good as it gets? Stepping over the cracks, stressing over these tracks. Steady lying through my teeth, so now it's nothing but facts. Steady riding to this beat, it's like I'm striking a match. Fire burning in my stomach like a furnace, I'm gassed. Never burn out, never been concerned about where the vermin lurk round. Look, I'll finish first now, second or third now. It's strictly bronze, strictly gold. We were a gold mine, but I gutted us. Guess it was go time, that's why I punished us. Jumped on a plane and plunged into the dark. I've been running from the pain, I'm running from the past. How many times I gotta say that every end has a start? Running from the pain, running from the past. Running from the pain, running from the past. How many times I gotta say it? Thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. Thank you. One more sad song from Stupid Rapper Boy. Hey. Atmospheric lemon. It's like... I'm a rotten apple, I'm a bad seed. Kinda hard to handle, pretty hard to leave. With these words I grapple, I can barely speak. You don't like yourself very much, please. Look, constantly question my character. Just trying to break down a barrier. Open the floodgates and let the water in. I hope the waves wash me of my sins. I hope the swell cleanse me of my fears. Destined for hell if you don't make up for the years of lying and cheating and cheating and lying. Yeah, cheating and lying. I got my Radiohead on, so it's no surprises. I know what a word from the wise is. It's no surprises. I know what a word from the wise is. Just need a word from the wise. They the first to decide if the bulb going dim or the light shining bright. I'm at the top of the lighthouse. Just trying to guide my ship home. Look, the waves are crashing and the rocks are jagged. The beacon flashing as I lift the fabric of your dress. In between your thighs, kissing on your neck. I look you in the eyes and tell you to be blessed. My ship just hit the ice, but I don't feel the stress. My heart is beating, I can feel it in my chest. Yeah, I can feel it in my chest. Cause you know it's still love. Said you know it's still love. Said you know it's still love. Said you know it's still love. Ay, and you know you my drug. Yeah, you know you my drug. Yeah, you know you my drug. Yeah, you know you my drug. Ay, look, you my drug. I could never get enough. Overdose on this love, comatose to the trust. I don't know how to fold, I don't know how to budge. I'm just, look, look. When the dust settles, we can pluck pearls. Finally feel mellow, finally feel mellow. When the dust settles, we can pluck pearls. Finally feel mellow, cause you know it's still love. Said you know it's still love, and you know you my drug. Said you know you my drug. I said you know it's still love, and you know you my drug. Yeah, you know you my drug. Yeah, you know you my drug. Thank you.
Fucking beast. Awesome, man. Thank you so much, brother. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. All right, guys. So, you know, that last song. Does anybody have any thoughts on whether or not we can consider love a drug?
Yeah?
Yeah. Awesome. Anybody else? Yeah. Maybe show of hands. Whose favorite drug is love in here? I'll speak to that one also. Maybe an addict as well. Maybe an addict as well. Alrighty, guys. So, oh, yes. Yeah, go for it. Great. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. So guys, I think it's my habit, and I'm sorry to do it. I wish that we could go until 11:30 every night, because I always only get to about half of what I have prepared for you guys, and I'm sorry. So here's what I'd like to do. I think I'm going to skip all the info on the war on drugs. I think it's important information, but maybe not as important for some kind of debate. And instead, we have a couple things left. So I think I'd like to give you some information just on the history of LSD. Yeah. Okay. Got some. Oops. That's good. That's a good sign. Thank you. A little bit on LSD. We can share some of our own experiences. If you are in a group with somebody who's ever taken it, you can talk about it a little bit. And then I'm gonna bring up Ed Weinberg. Ed, could you raise your hand for us? Thank you very much, Ed. Ed runs the Hanoi Zine Library here, along with Red. And Ed wanted to give us some information. Tell us a little bit about his experience taking ayahuasca in Cambodia and what that was all like. So we'll do that. Does that sound good? And then I think that we're going to call it a night. Does that sound all right, guys? All right. Awesome. 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 Thank you very much for being here, guys. All right. So a little bit about LSD. I'm a little nervous to do this. You don't have to respond, but if you want to respond, could I get a show of hands from people who've taken LSD in the past? Holy smokes! That's so much more than I thought that it was going to be. Wow! Keep them up for the photo. No, I'm kidding. I'm kidding. I'm kidding. Okay. Wild. So, I was a little concerned that we weren't going to have at least one person in every group who's done LSD. But it's like, maybe if you look at the Venn diagram of people... if you look at the Venn diagram of people who move out to Hanoi and then where that overlaps with people who've done LSD, maybe there's just a huge overlap in that section of the Venn diagram. I'm not too sure. That's good to know. That's good to know. So I'm going to give us some time in small groups to talk about our own personal experiences with it. Man, and you guys didn't want to show off your pictures. There are some flipping killer pictures in this audience that are pretty awesome. But I have to be a little bit lame, and I'm just gonna tell you some information about LSD. And this is really to contextualize it for everybody, because there maybe, God, it looked like half of us had taken it before, but just that we all know a little bit about where it's coming from. So some just very basic information about LSD. And if you want to chime in with some cool info that you know as well, I'll give you the freedom to do that. But we do have a bit of a time constraint tonight. We'll end at 10 o'clock. So LSD is non-addictive. It's a non-addictive chemical. At least we've never been able to prove that it's non-addictive, that it is addictive. Not only is it non-addictive, but it's also non-lethal. We've never found an amount of LSD that kills a person. We did once try to find out the amount of LSD that was able to kill an elephant. Has anybody heard of this one before? So we gave it, I think it was more than 100 doses of LSD before the elephant died. Now, the researcher said, okay, now we found the amount of LSD, but they had to sedate the elephant because the elephant was stumbling, and it's an elephant, it's this giant elephant. So it was really difficult to control. When it was on LSD, it was very difficult to control. So they had to give it so many sedatives that a lot of people say, no, it was not the LSD, it was the sedatives that killed the elephant. It was the sedatives. Okay. Yeah. Dear Lord, PETA should have been all over that, huh? Yeah, wow. Although, maybe it's a really lucky elephant. I'm not too sure. Okay, so normally on LSD, trips last somewhere between 8 to 12 hours. And in good trips, I'm just going to speed these out, people tend to report feelings of euphoria, ego dissolution. Maybe I'll break that one down quickly. So the ego maybe could be defined as the thing that lets me know that I'm different than you, that keeps me separate from everybody else. So when you dissolve the ego, you lose the feeling that you are separate from anyone else and anything else. The bounds from where you end and something else begins, it just fades away, and you feel as though you're just one, one with everything. Okay, so a lot of people have mystical experiences. Also, hallucinations are very common, of course, distorted perception and sensory images. So things may look a bit funnier, inspiring, or weird. Things that aren't there may appear, so you'll get these kind of hallucinations as well. Intriguing patterns might start to appear, so when just looking at some people, you might notice some patterns on their body. I will say that it seems like people who try to do interpretations of LSD, they're doing their best estimate at what it's like on LSD, but it's almost as if you're moving into, I don't have any experience, but it's as if you're moving into a place that you just can't describe with words, you just can't describe in paintings, and you're indirectly pointing at it as well as you can. Now, there are also bad trips associated with LSD, and I don't want to skirt over this. It's a really important part of... It's a really important part of the story. I've had two friends that were very close to me who took too much LSD. And I think for all intents and purposes, you could say that they lost their mind. They and still, both of them today, as far as I know, are homeless. And it was directly associated with doing LSD. I don't want to get too personal here, but I was getting text messages from a friend telling me that he was having conversations with future John. And he was having these conversations by writing on his bed sheets, and messages from his bed sheets were from future John were appearing to him. Not only these messages, but also in his bed sheets, he was intercepting messages from the Hanoi Beautiful Facebook group. Okay. So, in a lot of these bad trips, you have a feelings of being out of control. You get incredible anxiety and paranoia. The hallucinations become terrifying. They're like a really bad nightmare that you're just not able to stop. Okay. So, we can talk a little bit. Yeah, Kyle. So for anybody who didn't hear, he said, just because it's not addictive doesn't mean that it can't be abused, right? So certainly going to spin cycle classes can become addictive in that way, right? Yeah, almost anything. Yeah, great.
great. But the chemical compound doesn't produce the same kind of chemical addiction as other drugs do. Okay, so this is Albert Hofmann. So Albert Hofmann was a Swiss chemist. And in 1938, he was trying to develop a respiratory and circulatory stimulant from the molecules that were found in ergo, which is a fungus that grows on grains. Grains like, you know, like rye bread. Okay, so he found this fungus and he was trying to see if it was possible to turn it into a respiratory and circulatory stimulant. And he inadvertently created LSD. He did not want to create this. He didn't mean to. It was a total fluke. It was a total accident. He didn't understand what it was, and he didn't try it at first. But it wasn't working for what he wanted it to work for. So he didn't find it useful, and it was shelved for 5 years. It was put on the shelf, and then eventually, in 1943, Hofmann accidentally ingested a very, very small amount of LSD. And of this experience, this is from his own personal memoir, he says, "I was affected by a remarkable restlessness, combined with a slight dizziness. At home, I lay down and sank into a not unpleasant, intoxicated-like condition, characterized by an extremely stimulated imagination. In a dreamlike state, with eyes closed, I found the daylight to be unpleasantly glaring. I perceived an uninterrupted stream of fantastic pictures, extraordinary shapes with intense kaleidoscopic play of colors. After about 2 hours, this condition faded away." So that was probably the first LSD trip that was ever recorded in history. And also, interestingly, the one that comes without any expectation. I think today we see all of this psychedelic art and we have some assumptions about what an LSD trip is supposed to be like. This was the first time that it was just somebody had no idea what to expect. Okay, so same guy, Albert Hofmann. Oh, look at that for hours. Okay. So after he had this experience, he decided to continue experimenting a bit further. And on April 19th, he took 0.25 milligrams of LSD. For anybody who's not familiar with LSD, it is a tiny, 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 tiny droplet that's able to get you high. Very, very small amounts. So he took 0.25 milligrams of LSD, and in his autobiography, it said, "Things started happening." So he was escorted home on a bicycle by a friend, and he freaked out when he got home. It was in his lab that he took it, and then he went home on the bicycle. He freaked out, and he thought that the next-door neighbor was a malevolent witch. So he then went to the doctor. The friend took him to the doctor because he was certain that he was dying. And then the doctor reassured him that he was physically fine. And from this moment on, he was actually able to enjoy the experience as soon as he thought that he was no longer dying. Okay. And even with this, just with the second trip, he experienced what's known as ego disillusion, the feeling as though he's just, the barrier between him and anything else is completely dissolved. So to this day, LSD enthusiasts still celebrate what they call Bicycle Day on the 19th of April every year. I need to say now, I might have messed up a bit royally, legally, but I need to say, and I do say, that the Hanoi Philosophy Forum does not promote or endorse the use of any illicit substances. The information that's being given here is purely for educational purposes and for harm reduction, so please take that with you. Okay. So Albert Hofmann went on to say that everything glistened and sparkled in fresh light. The world was as if newly created. Okay, so then, a few years later, there's a guy called Humphrey Osmond. And in the 1950s, LSD was made available for researchers. And at first, they wanted to use LSD so that they could help psychiatrists understand madness. They thought if the psychiatrist took LSD and it created a mad, a mentally insane experience for them, then they'd maybe be able to better understand and connect with and heal their patients. But they didn't find this to actually be successful at all. And instead, in 1953, Osmond began to experiment using LSD to treat alcoholism.
at this time, there wasn't the same milieu, there wasn't the same taboo against talking about psychedelics. They saw it to be this just new, exciting frontier to better understand the human mind. The term psychedelic, he said it translates to mind manifesting. Mind being psyche and manifest being delos, like delic. Okay, so psychedelic, mind manifesting. And he said what he loved about this term is that it's not really going to get confused with other terms. It's its own thing. It's its own thing. Okay, so that's where the word psychedelic comes from. And then this guy, Aldous Huxley. Was anybody able to read The Doors of Perception that was on the forum's website? Okay, just a couple of us. If you get the opportunity, we won't be able to go as far as detail with any of these things as I'd like, but I'd really recommend reading this text. There's a free link to it on the Hanoi Philosophy Forum group Facebook group page that you can access and read. It's really great. So Aldous Huxley, he wrote The Doors of Perception in 1964, and this was not about his experience on LSD. It was actually about his experience on mescaline, and but it influenced the culture on LSD pretty massively. So they're relatively comparable psychedelic experiences. So he'd been administered this mescaline by a researcher, and in his experience that's noted in The Doors of Perception, he said that he encountered, quote, the mind at large in everyday objects. He said, the fold of my gray flanneled trousers were charged with isness. The allness and infinity of folded cloth. So at one point there was an exchange between Humphrey Osmond and Aldous Huxley. Huxley wrote to Osmond, there were these strange letters going back and forth. He said, to make this trivial world sublime, take half a gram of phenerothyme, okay. And then Osmond in response said, to fall in hell or soar angelic, you'll need a pinch of psychedelic. Okay. And then enters the picture, Al Hubbard. Has anybody heard of Al Hubbard before? I don't think anybody has, but he's a pretty cool guy. So Al Hubbard, he's also called Captain Trips. Maybe you've heard of him by that name. Yeah. Captain Trips. Okay, oh, now everybody's got him. All right. And he's called the Johnny Appleseed of LSD. So he had no formal training in psychotherapy, and in fact, he only received a third grade education. But in the 1920s, he was under investigation by Congress for illegal smuggling. So he's an American, and he was being investigated by Congress for illegal smuggling. So he left America, and he went to Canada. And in Canada, he started getting involved in the uranium mining business, and he started a charter boat company, and he became a millionaire by the age of 50. Okay, so during World War II, it's reported, and this, we don't really know how true this is, right? He never confirmed this, but there are many people who say that this is true, that during World War II, he joined the OSS, which was the OSS predates the CIA. It became the CIA after the end of World War II. Okay, so same guy, Al Hubbard, just a couple years later. after experimenting with LSD, he felt that he had a special chosen role to play in bringing this experience to as many people as possible. He really considered it to be a kind of philanthropy. And if you know of any of the other guys around this time, they really thought it was their life's message, their life's mission, their calling to give as many people LSD as possible. I think that there was a Kickstarter recently to hire a kind of LSD hitman to spike one of Donald Trump's drinks with LSD so that he wakes up. And I think that they got to something like $60,000 to hire this hitman before Kickstarter shut down the campaign. My exact numbers there might be off, but that's the general story. Okay, so he had these connections, maybe through the OSS, through the smuggling business. Somehow he knew a lot of crooked people, and he was able to receive an obscene amount of LSD. And he wrote that he had the plan to liberate human consciousness. So from 1951 to 1966, he administered 6,000 people with LSD. And kind of like the Church of Scientology, he wanted to go with the top-down approach. So he chose as many influential people as possible to to administer this to first. So we're talking about not really politicians, but as many professors as he could find who would want to do this, successful advertisers, successful artists, successful engineers, to all do LSD, talk about their experience so that more people would be interested in doing it. So it's debated, again, because of his CIA history, whether or not he was a part of MK Ultra, which was a CIA program, this is real, where the American government secretly began administering LSD to American citizens to see what the effects of LSD would be, and it's questioned whether or not Al Hubbard was actually the one behind MK Ultra. Oh man, we did conspiracy theories a couple weeks ago, and all right, don't want to step into that territory. Okay, so we're gonna move on to Mr. Timothy Leary, who's probably the most famous LSD enthusiast in history, in LSD history. So, Tim Leary, he was a professor of clinical psychology at Harvard University. Is anybody familiar with Jordan Peterson, by chance? Jordan Peterson? So, Jordan Peterson held for, I think, 5 years, the position that Tim Leary held at Harvard University. After he left, Jordan Peterson, I think it was one generation later, took over for Tim Leary. Tim Leary was also very good friends with Dick Halpert, who, after experimenting with LSD, became Ram Dass, if anyone is familiar with them. Both of them... clinical psychology professors at Harvard University. So while at the university, while he was still a professor of clinical psychology, he administered psilocybin to hundreds of people, to students, to other professors, to people just on the street, and unfortunately, throughout these experiments, he actually accomplished very little. The effects of LSD are just so difficult to quantify that there wasn't really any data that came out of these experiments. They were brand new, they didn't know what they were doing really, they didn't have the same kind of academic rigor that we're experimenting with today at places like Johns Hopkins University or MAPS, where they're really, they figured out new ways to quantify these things. They didn't have any of that. And unfortunately, he was actually fired from his place at Harvard University, and he was accused of many ethical problems. Okay, so this caused the public face of LSD to take a real downward fall. So Tim Leary was the public face, and he was doing all of these experiments, maybe with people where they didn't know that they were actually taking LSD. People were having really bad trips. They didn't know about set and setting. They were using it maybe as a party drug. He was taking LSD with the people that he was experimenting on at the time. So there were a lot of newspaper articles that were saying, is this actual scientific research, or is this just a party? And so now, LSD, the idea of the research, is wrapped up with Tim Leary. And because of this, there's a link that began to develop between psychedelics and counterculture. Now, psychedelics began in academia, but then because of, I don't want to demonize him too much, but because of Tim Leary, they started to really be associated with counterculture as they are today. And they really haven't escaped that until very, very recently that some established universities are taking on this challenge. So by the mid-1960s, psychiatric establishments began to decry psychedelic research. Bad trips myths became urban legends. And unfortunately, so you hear about the experience of one person, and the next time that you do LSD, this will come in your mind, and maybe what you make in your mind you manifest while in LSD. So these bad trip fears became bad trip realities. And in the late 1960s, there was full-on moral panic. There's a lot about political figures intentionally trying to suppress the hippie counterculture and protesters. And there seemed to be a lot of correlation between having your mind awoken through these drugs and being and going up against the government. So the government intentionally tried to quash it as much as possible, putting out as much propaganda and creating laws keeping people from taking these substances. So also, it was mostly associated with young people, so there was a lot of fear from older people. Okay, then in the mid-1970s, all official psychedelic research was shut down, sometimes in the middle of these experiments with people who are making real headway. You hear some of these stories. But, you know, it didn't stop. The psychedelic research didn't stop. It just went underground, and it stayed there, and it's continued all the way up until today. Finally, we have a kind of resurgence, which is really great. And one of the biggest studies that's come out recently is this 2016 Imperial College London study. So I'm sorry, I know that the text is small here. I'm sorry. So they scanned people's brains while they were undergoing LSD trips so that they could visualize the way that LSD alters the brain, because we just didn't know. LSD has a disorganizing influence on cortical activity. Cortical activity is just brain function. So it disorganizes the things that are in the brain. And what that means is that there are areas of the brain that are that usually communicate with one another, right? Parts of language communicating with parts of math, right, in certain parts of the brain. Okay, that's common. But then when you take LSD, they found that parts of the brain that generally don't talk to one another begin to talk to one another. So has anybody heard of synesthesia before? So a lot of people who take LSD experience synesthesia, which is where you begin to hear colors and see sounds and smell music. Okay, so it crosses all of these different parts of the brain. And it also decreases communication between areas that normally are communicating with one another. And this is probably why we experience things like these strange hallucinations. Maybe what we're seeing is a visual representation of something that we might actually be hearing or might actually be smelling. We don't really know a lot about it. We're still kind of on the forefront of this, and we're just going to keep on finding out more and more and more. Okay, so also, this thing, ego dissolution, once again, it's where the idea of the self seems to begin to break down. Has anybody been able to read Michael Pollan's book, How to Change Your Mind, by chance? Michael Pollan, New York Times bestseller for a very long time, and Harvard University professor of journalism, recently spent, I think, 5 or 6 years doing as many psychedelics as he could, and wrote about it in this, and he had the experience of experiencing ego dissolution. And I can't fit it just in a PowerPoint here, but I'd really recommend finding out more about this book. Okay. And doing a little bit of reading. So what we're going to do now, I'd like to talk first to Ed Weinberg, and then maybe we can have a little discussion of this question, and then I think that we'll wrap things up. So actually, I'm even going to skip this. I think we're just going to finish with Ed, just for the sake of time. So I'd love to bring up Ed Weinberg. Round of applause for Ed Weinberg, please. Thank you.
Hi, everybody. Does everybody know what ayahuasca is here? How many people? Show of hands. Okay. So ayahuasca is a psychedelic drug. It's sort of, it's in the same ballpark as LSD and psilocybin and DMT. It actually contains DMT, which is called the spirit molecule. And on the scale of drugs that are like recreational and you fuck around with at parties, to drugs that you prepare for, drugs that change your life, it's much more on that scale. So 2 years ago, year and a half ago, I did ayahuasca that was administered by this white dude in Cambodia who he somehow got a hold of the components or things that synthesize the experience. And basically it's two components. One that has MAOI, which inhibits something I can't pronounce, and DMT. DMT is said to be the drug that is released when you dream and when you die. In my experience with ayahuasca, I came to understand that by kind of seeing my life flash before my eyes so quickly that I couldn't really keep track of it. I just saw these scenes from my life. But anyway, let me ground you. So we did the set and setting, which is an important part of psychedelics. It's basically controlling your environment. Because it's not fun to do acid at a party with, loud and disruptive people. It's nicer to do it in a quiet room or in a meadow. That's actually ideal. So anyway, we rented an Airbnb in the middle of Phnom Penh, and we blacked out the windows, and we got a bunch of mattresses and couches on the ground, and we all had puke buckets right next to us, and this guy, he played like tribal chanting music on the CD player, and we did the drug, and we were told we had to hold it in for 15 minutes before puking, which is a normal reaction with ayahuasca. And yeah, so we sat down for these 15 minutes, and we all sort of really kept quietly to ourselves with our own thoughts. And it was really intense at first. A lot of people say that it seems like you're maybe going through space-time like these vortexes, you know, this geometry, or maybe blood vessels or something. But it's just this really fast, really intense strobing of patterns. And when it finally slowed down, the first image I saw was in my childhood backyard. It was this merry-go-round that had been built by the original owner of the house in the 1950s. And it was this rusted merry-go-round. It was sort of like swaying in the wind. And I felt tremendously sad at seeing it, because I immediately knew what it represented. And it represented a lack of attention being paid to my roots and where I came from, and maintaining these roots, and even thinking about them. And that was the first point that I sort of held on to. And a lot of people say ayahuasca is like 6 years of therapy in 6 hours. And it kind of was for me. I saw a number of other images. Those are the only things I was able really to hold on to after the experience. One of the images was my head and my dad's head somehow superimposed upon each other, and it made me feel like I understood his infantile insecurities in the same way I suddenly understood my own. I saw a scene that my mother had described to me recently at that point. You know how when you go to, home to your parents, and maybe they tell you stories about your childhood, and it's always the same story for like a few weeks? That's how my parents are anyway. My mom had told me this story of when I was young, my parents both worked a lot, and they had a really harsh and shrill 70-year-old Russian Jewish nanny, and she... She would leave immediately once my parents came home. And one time they came and I said a full sentence. I don't know how old I was, but around the talking age. And my mom was astounded that I said not only my first word, but a full sentence. And she was like, my boy is a genius to this nanny. And this very harsh woman, she said, that's not his first word. He's been talking for 6 weeks. And she followed that immediately by saying, you never hear him talk, because the second he points at something, you always just get it. And when I heard this story at first, I was like, oh yeah, mom, you're a helicopter parent. This is what you do. I get it. But then on ayahuasca, I experienced this story from her perspective, like just fully, like it was like I was there. And I felt... I mean, I hadn't felt these feelings before, but this intense empathy for my mom in this situation, not only having this very special moment robbed from her, but then being told that it didn't matter, and it was her fault. Yeah, so that's just a few of the really intense and wonderful things I got out of it. Not everybody in the room had as meaningful a time as me. My friend had a real run of bad luck. Her ex-boyfriend had overdosed and died 2 months after they broke up. And she was still holding a lot of that, and she was hoping that ayahuasca would help her to deal with these feelings better and show her a way to deal with it. And instead, the only thing she felt was the most intense stabbing pain in her stomach for 15 minutes. And then she claimed that she was all right and she wasn't high. So I guess, you know, everybody gets different things out of it. I think all nine of us in that room, we left having had this experience that changed us in some way. And one of the real challenges is, you know, like knowing I have these flaws, like I don't pay enough attention to my parents' empathy and really practicing them and putting them to work on your life. But yeah, John was talking about the prohibition that we've been under with psychedelic drugs in particular. Maybe marijuana is getting legalized, but the drugs that I'm really optimistic about the future of are psychedelics, MDMA, things that can change people's lives for the better. And they've been shown to. And they're currently undertaking research, Johns Hopkins, on PTSD sufferers, post-traumatic stress disorder sufferers. It's been shown to, you know, take them out of this like an incredible amount of the time. Tim Leary, one of the studies he did was give drugs to people who just gotten out of prison, and their recidivism, their committing crimes again rates went from 85%. 85% of people leaving prison in the U.S. committing crimes again and getting sent back to prison to much less. 15%. I mean, like, these things have outstanding potential, and I think the onus is on the research institutions and the governments of the world to integrate them into our societies in positive ways, not in ways where people take them, you know, in stupid, overcrowded music festivals, and, you know, bad things happen, and then there's this whole reactionary cycle. I'm optimistic for the future because I think, well, normally ayahuasca journeys down to Peru that you find on the internet, they're like $1,600 US per person. And basically, I don't think that's great, but a lot more people are taking these drugs intentionally. They have jobs, they have families, they're not people from the US 1960s who just wanted to take LSD and drop out of society. They're people who are using these things for specific reasons and hoping to gain from them and bring them into their lives. And I think that's a pretty optimistic thing that we're going through right now. Thank you guys.
I'll check the time quickly. It's 10:02 now, so if it's past anybody's bedtime, I understand. But maybe we'll take one or two questions for Ed from anybody who has them. Yeah, please.
Were all the images and stories that you saw while you were on it either real ones from your memory, or like there was nothing that was completely like fantasy?
I mean, I didn't. A lot of people talk about interacting with a snake-like spirit mother ayahuasca. I didn't see her. I mean, a lot of things are really, really hazy because they were happening so fast. I have that real question, but in terms of what I saw, I'd term them more as visions than hallucinations because they were so real. Like, you know, I still can see that image. It's kind of like burned into my mind of this merry-go-round.
And presumably you took it stank or sober?
Yeah, there's... I don't know how much of this is ritual and how much of this is fact, but there's a whole list of foods you're not supposed to eat for 3 days before. No pork, no fermented foods. Fermented foods are supposed to be dangerous. You're supposed to abstain from sex for, I don't know, a week or 3 days. You're not supposed to do any other drugs for 2 weeks before then. You're definitely not supposed to be on any psychoactive prescription drugs. Yeah, the ritual is really intense with it, which is, I think, something that lent to my experience being so good.
And
Thank you very much, Ed. One more round of applause, please, for Ed Weinberg. Yeah. Thank you so much, guys. So up here, we do have one more piece of artwork that was provided, created for us by Laura Hardy Stewart. If you want to take a look, it's just up here on the table, if anybody would like to inspect the real one. Inspect the real one here. But I had a lot more that I wanted to get to with you guys tonight. We just didn't have the time. Puku stays open. Oh, Laura, here she is. Laura, do you want to come on up? Yeah. And if you'd like, I asked her just to say one or two words about her piece. We're well after 10 right now, actually. So if you'd like to say something. Oh, awesome. Thank you. And actually, before she speaks, somebody might have dropped their motorbike key card, it looks like. Their motorbike parking card. Does this belong to anybody or know who it might be? No. Okay. All right, then.
Hi, once again, I'm really late, but thanks so much. I don't really want to talk about the piece, but John suggested that maybe I talk about why I drew it the way that I did. And I've always had quite a complex attitude towards drugs. On one hand, I want to be really cool. On the other hand, I'm a bit of a square. Like, I'm not quite sure what my feelings towards it are. Because depending who you talk to, I'm a wild, like, off the tracks. But if you talk to somebody else, I'm like, I'm not fun at all, and I'm a bit of a wet blanket. So it's quite difficult, because I think my attitude is pretty liberal, but sometimes it's not. And the whole thing about drugs and our approach to it, not only as a society, but on an individual basis, is often a confusing, ambivalent and complex thing. It doesn't matter really how you feel about it. Other people will shape your experience with it and your interaction. I had a coworker back where I lived, South Africa, who'd dealt so much MDMA that her name was Dr. Lauren, because she was Lauren MD. So she did like a lot of drugs, and she once said, "Thank goodness my eyes are brown because nobody can see how large my pupils are all the time." She was just like gone. And I thought maybe I'd talk to her about it, ask her why. And something that she said that stuck with me quite a while, she said, "Everyone is okay with the idea of you being drunk. That's just my drunk self. But then when people take drugs, they have this idea that you're an entirely different person. That I'm scared I take drugs. What if I do something out of control? What if I'm not me?" And she found that idea completely ridiculous. Why would you not be you? And she said that for her, drugs was an extension of oneself. And what that extension is totally dependent on yourself and your experience. A lot of people, I've missed the fantastic presentation, I'm so sorry, but I'm sure there are many drugs for different purposes and for different reasons, and everyone's going to have a different experience. And in that part, you're going to find a different part of you. You're going to have to face a different part of you. Sometimes it's going to be a good time. Sometimes you're going to really like holding your own hand and entering that void. Other times, you're going to be like, who am I? But the point is, whatever you do, whatever experience you have, is just another way of learning about yourself. And sometimes I think, in my experience, my personal experience and my experience with my friends, people I know and love, sometimes the excess can blur those lines. And I think some people forget about who they are without it. Which is good for some, to get out of that comfort of knowing oneself wholly. Other people want to know all faces of themselves. But it's hard to kind of balance that line and be happy with all of the extensions of yourself and be okay with knowing the ones, even the ones that are really hard to talk to and deal with. So yeah, this was basically about kind of the kind of person I think I am when I'm sober and when I'm not. But at the end of the day, those people are all me.
Thank you very much for having us there. Thank you. Thank you. Well, alrighty, guys, we did it. We got through the whole night. We have a couple of pretty cool things coming up over the next couple of weeks. These are all going to be online. We do this every Wednesday, except the 27th of November. We won't be here, so just try not to come here then. Puku stays open until, it never closes. So sometimes people hang out here until around 3 or 4 in the morning. So if you want to continue the conversation, you're certainly invited. I'm going to bring David back up on stage one last time. Can we get another round of applause for David, please? Pretty amazing. So there are a lot of people to thank, actually, to help put this on. Could if your name is up here, David, Helen, Mai Chung, David, Laura, James, Ed, Lemon, Raphael, Killian, Huai, if you could stand up real quickly and just give a round of applause for all of you guys. Thank you so much for putting this on tonight. Thank you, Killian. Thank you, Ed. Thank you, Lemon. Thank you very much, guys. So I love you all, and I'm really grateful for the opportunity to get to do this with you all each week. Come and say hi if it's your first time. Good night.